शुरू कर दो। हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम प्रोफेसर पंचापकेशन फ्रॉम यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द मॉड्यूल लैंप शिफ्ट एंड रीनॉर्मलाइजेशन। दिस इज फ्रॉम द पेपर रेडिएशन थियोरी इन द कोर्स फिजिक्स। आफ्टर गोइंग थ्रू द मॉड्यूल यू विल बी एबल टू नो अबाउट सेल्फ एनर्जी ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन due to interaction with its own electromagnetic field and how the mass of the electron changes due to emission and absorption of virtual photons. You will learn how the shift in energy is divergent and how the idea of mass renormalization due to Cramer's helps in getting a finite and correct value of the shift of the line, called usually lamp shift. A counter term is convenient for order by order calculation. You will also see how the calculation is related to calculation of the imaginary part of the line width introduced in the last module. In Dirac theory of the hydrogen atom, the energy levels are designated by the quantum number n, l and s. The total angular momentum vector J is given by J equal to L vector plus S vector. The value of energy level depends only on the total angular momentum and not on L or S. The energy levels are shown in the following diagram. You can see the energy level 2P is on top, but the energy levels of 2S half and 2P 3 half, they are mixed up. And they are all separate. Yeah. But in experiment, when you observe, we notice that two levels being coincident, which is usually called degenerate, no longer exists in the experimental observation. In the experimental observation, the levels 2s and 2p, which are degenerate on the left, become separated with 2p going down and 2s 3 by 2 going up. In Dirac theory, the 2s half and 2p half levels are degenerate and have the same value, while 2p 3 half is shifted up slightly. The spectroscopic evidence leads one to believe that 2s half and 2p half levels were separated slightly. Utilizing the tremendous improvement achieved in microwave technology during Second World War, W.E. Lamb and his student E.C. Rutherford were able to measure the difference of these two levels in 1946-47 and found it to be 1040 or 1040 megahertz. The absence of other explanations pointed to the shift being due to quantum field theoretic effects. In 1948, Hans Bethe, using Cramer's idea of renormalization, was able to obtain a theoretical value close to the experimental one. This was the beginning of the successful application of the ideas of renormalization. In this module, we calculate the self-energy of an electron bound to the atom using quantum field theory. The electron is treated non-relativistically, while the radiation field is described by the electromagnetic field vector capital A mu. The module is divided as follows. In section 2, we obtain the self-energy expression starting from the idea of the last unit dealing with the line shift. In section 3, Cramer's idea is developed to give an expression for the lamp shift. In section 4, we deal with the elementary ideas of mass renormalization. In section 5, we briefly discuss vacuum polarization and charge renormalization. We first discuss the self-energy of the electron. We saw in the previous module that the imaginary part of gamma was associated with shift in the frequency of the spectral line. Let us define delta Ea equal to imaginary part of gamma by 2 and associate it with shift of the level A. Then we have from equation 319 of module M12 the delta of Ea is the principal value part of the matrix element of Hi between I and A mod squared divided by E capital A minus E capital I minus omega. Here we have generalized the expression to take account of the possibility of more than two levels in the atom. As we are not interested in regions where the denominator vanishes, we will drop the principal value symbol P. We notice that delta Ea corresponds to the second order matrix element for the diagram, which is shown in the picture, where an electron comes, emitted a photon, absorbs it again in the intermediate state, and goes back to the original value. And this gives the matrix element delta Ea is sum over the intermediate states I, product of H prime between matrix element A and I, and H prime between I and A, divided by capital Ea minus capital Ei minus omega. Here the summation is over the electron levels as well as the various ranges of photon energies. The above diagram is usually called the self-energy diagram, where an electron or a particle emits a photon and reabsorbs it. The photon is a virtual photon. As H prime Ia is equal to matrix element between I and A of 1 over root 2 omega minus E by M P vector dot epsilon vector into exponential minus IK vector X dot vector. From equation 2.2 then, we can write it in the form of delta Ea is equal to E squared by M squared sum over I integral over D cubed K over 2 pi cubed into 1 by 2 omega and summation over polarization lambda of P dot epsilon matrix element between I and A and exponential minus I k dot x mod squared divided by Ea minus Ei minus omega, where k vector mod is equal to energy omega. There is no conservation of energy in the intermediate state, and so we have summation over I and integration over k and summation over lambda separately. Using dipole approximation, exponential minus I k vector dot x vector approaches 1, and integral over dr summation over polarization of the matrix element of p dot epsilon I a whole squared, we get the value 8 pi by 3 p vector matrix element between I and A mod squared. We get delta Ea is equal to 2 over 3 pi into alpha by m squared summation over states I integral from 0 to infinity, matrix element between I and A mod squared, omega into d omega, divided by Ea minus Ei minus omega. It is clear from this equation 2.7 that the integral diverges at the upper limit. If we denote the upper limit by omega equal to capital K, delta Ea goes like limit of K as K goes to infinity. This self-energy, delta Ea, we say, has therefore a linear divergence. It goes linear in K. This self-energy correction exists even in the absence of any external field, as spontaneous emission or absorption is possible due to self-field of the electron. However, as it seemed infinite, it was ignored till lamp shift was measured. As mentioned earlier, Hans Bethe, using the Cramer's idea of renormalization, was able to obtain a theoretical value close to the experimental one. Cramer's idea and lamp shift. As energy shifts of a free electron and a bound electron both diverge, we subtract from the infinite self-energy of the bound electron the infinite self-energy of the free electron. We expect a finite value for the result, which can be identified with lamp shift. This kind of subtraction was first suggested by H.A. Cramer's to get over the problem of divergences in the theory. It was reformulated using a mass counter term by Z. Koba and S. Tomonaga in 1947. To handle infinities in a consistent way, the theory was cast in a relativistic covariant form later by Schwinger, Tomonaga, and Feynman. Here we study why Bethe's non-relativistic theory, which is sufficiently illustrative for our purposes. Let us calculate self-energy of the free electron. We need not make the dipole approximation. Now, for free electron, we have P dot epsilon, matrix element between I and A, is equal to P dot epsilon into delta function of Pi vector minus P vector plus K vector, as shown in equation 3.1. Pi vector dot epsilon lambda vector is equal to P vector minus K vector dot epsilon lambda vector, which is equal to P dot epsilon vector, as K dot epsilon is 0. That is, P dot epsilon vector matrix element between I and A is equal to P dot epsilon vector only. Now, Ea minus E capital I minus omega is equal to P squared by 2m minus P vector minus K vector whole squared by 2m minus omega, which is equal to P squared by 2m minus P squared by 2m plus P dot K by m minus K squared by 2m minus K. And this is all closely approximated by V vector dot K minus K by 2 into K by m minus K. And they are equal to minus K vector approximately, since V vector is much less than 1 and K is much less than m. Hence, the expression delta Ea for self-energy of a free electron reduces to delta Ea for the free electron of the order of minus 2 over 3 pi alpha by m squared into p squared integral over dk, which goes from 0 to k, but k approaches infinity. Subtracting 3.4 from 2.7 and using p vector squared is equal to the matrix element of p squared between A and A, which is equal to sum over I of PIA whole squared, and omega d omega can be written as KDK. We have delta Ea observed, which is defined as delta Ea bound minus delta Ea free, is given by the expression 2 over 3 pi alpha by m squared integral from 0 to K, capital K, sum over I, matrix element of PIA whole squared, multiplied by K divided by Ea minus Ei minus K plus 1 dk, which is of the order of 2 by 3 pi alpha by m squared, summation over PIA squared, Ea minus Ei, integral 0 to K of dk over Ea minus Ei minus K. Therefore, using this, delta Ea observed is equal to 2 over 3 pi alpha by m squared, summation over I, P between I and A square into Ea minus Ei into log of capital K by Ei minus Ea modulus. As K is much greater than Ei minus Ea, we can replace Ei minus Ea by Ea minus Ea average, which is defined by the equation delta Ea observed is equal to 2 over 3 pi alpha by m squared log of K divided by Ea minus Ea modular average multiplied by matrix element of PIA whole squared into Ea minus Ei. Considering now the sum PIA squared into Ei minus Ea summed over all I's equal to half sum over I matrix element of P between A and I minus matrix element of H naught P vector between I and A minus H naught P commutator matrix element between A and I into P vector matrix element between I and A. The whole thing then reduces to half into matrix element between the same state A of P vector commuted with the commutator of H naught and P vector. Now H naught P vector commutator is equal to P vector squared by 2m plus V commuted with P vector, which is equal to V R vector into P vector, which is equal to I delta of V or gradient of V, as P vector is equal to minus I delta. So we have P vector commutator of P vector with commutator of H naught P vector is equal to P vector into I delta V vector, which is equal to delta squared of Vr, which is equal to E squared delta function delta cubed of R. Hence, from 3.7 and 3.8, we have Pi A squared into Ei minus Ea sum over all I is equal to half of delta squared V between the states A and A, which is equal to E squared by 2 into modulus of psi A at the point 0 whole squared. Now, the ground state psi A at 0 is given by psi A 0 mod squared equal to 1 over pi n cubed A naught cubed for all S states with L equal to 0, but it is equal to 0 for all other L's. Substituting 3.9 and 3.10 and 3.6, delta Ea observed is equal to 2 by 3 pi alpha by m squared into E squared by 2, 1 over pi n cubed A naught cubed log of capital K by Ei minus Ea average. As the Bohr radius A naught is equal to 1 over alpha m, we rewrite 311 as delta Ea observed is equal to 8 pi by 3 pi alpha cubed E squared by 8 pi A naught 1 over n cubed log of K by Ei minus Ea average. Equation 312 gives us the shift energy of 2s half called the lamp shift. For electrons, we take capital K equal to m, mass of the electron. Ei minus Ea average is equal to 17 Rydberg by calculation. For S states, E squared by 8 pi A naught is the Rydberg energy for the ground state of the hydrogen atom. We have 1 Rydberg is equal to 13.6 electron volts, and mass of the electron is 511 into 10 raised to the power 3 electron volts. So, log of K by Ei minus Ea average is equal to log of 5.11 into 10 raised to the power 3 divided by 17 into 13.6, which is roughly of the order of 7. Substituting these values in 312, delta E observed is 10,040 megahertz. The experimental value of lamp shift is 1057.7 plus or minus 0.2. So this shows a remarkable agreement. Also, it justifies the use of quantum field theory and Bethe's method of calculation. Bethe used a cutoff capital K of the order of m. You also notice that linear divergence becomes logarithmic divergence after subtraction. In the relativistic treatment, we get a logarithmic divergence which becomes a finite value on subtraction. Mass renormalization. The philosophy behind subtraction leads us to mass renormalization. Writing E equal to E free plus delta E, from equation 3.4, we have E is equal to P squared by 2m naught minus 2 by 3 pi alpha by m naught squared into P squared into integral 0 to k of dk, which is equal to P squared by 2m naught into 1 minus 1 over m naught into 4 alpha by 3 into integral over dk 0 to k, which can be written as P squared by 2m naught into 1 minus delta m over m naught, or E is equal to P squared over twice m naught plus delta m plus terms of order delta m by m naught whole squared or higher. And where delta m is defined as delta m equal to 4 alpha by 3 pi integral from 0 to capital K of dk. Writing the Hamiltonian in terms of m, the mass, the mass m naught is equal to m minus delta of m. The Hamiltonian H is H radiation plus P squared over twice m minus delta m minus E over twice m minus delta m into P vector dot A vector plus E squared by m squared into A vector whole squared, which can be further written as H radiation plus P squared by 2m plus delta m by m into P squared by 2m minus E by 2 P vector dot A vector plus E squared by m squared A vector squared plus terms of order E cubed and higher. If we calculate delta E for free electron with this Hamiltonian, the contribution due to minus E by 2 P dot A and delta m by m or P squared by 2m cancel each other to give a true shift. This is the idea of mass renormalization. When we calculate delta E for the bound electron, the inclusion of both these terms corresponds to calculating delta E bound minus delta E free. Thus, the Hamiltonian expressed in terms of the observed mass has the subtraction idea built into it. The expansion delta M by M is taken to be in powers of alpha, so we can neglect higher powers of alpha. We are not bothering about the fact that delta M itself is infinite in this formal treatment. Delta M is equal to 4 alpha by 3 pi integral over dk going from 0 to capital K is only up to order alpha. If we wish to calculate higher orders of minus E by M into P vector dot A vector, then delta M also has to be calculated to higher orders to eliminate divergences in that order. We have not so far considered the term E squared by M squared A vector dot A vector, which corresponds to the following diagram called Siegel. You can see the diagram. In principle, the Siegel term also contributes to self-energy. However, as it is independent of momentum, it is the same for free and bound electron. So there is no finite shift for the bound electron. Hence, its contribution to delta M is trivial. The shift for L not equal to zero states vanishes due to the approximation made in defining EI minus EA average. In actual process, there is a shift for other states also, though it is very small. Vacuum polarization and charge renormalization. In the study of Dirac theory of electron in quantum mechanics, you may have learnt about hole theory or negative energy electron states. According to Dirac, these states are all filled up and by Pauli principle, and because of Pauli principle, the vacuum has no further room for electrons. However, this electrons in negative energy states can be polarized like in a dielectric. This polarization will induce a redistribution of the charges of the electron placed in Dirac's vacuum. The electron will attract a charge plus delta E around it and send a charge minus delta E to infinity. The vacuum polarization will also contribute to change in the energy level of the electrons in 2s state. This was calculated by Ewing in 1936. The 2s 3 by 2 level is lowered, 2s half level is lowered by 27 megahertz. This has also to be taken into account in calculating the correct lamp shift. In this module, we have learnt that glimpse into how finite corrections are calculated to the results of quantum field theory by renormalizing the calculated values. Since the values are divergent, this is a very delicate issue. The observation of lamp shift was a crucial first step in this revolution, followed by further successful calculation in later years. The success of the relativistic calculation shows that most of the contribution to lamp shift comes from lower frequency non-relativistic region. We obtained the shift in the 2s half and the 2p half state to be of value 1040 megahertz, which is very close to the experimental value of 1057 megahertz. In evaluating this, we followed the treatment of Bethe, who used the Cramer's idea of mass renormalization. It is seen that by this subtraction method and using a cutoff value of the order of the mass of the electron, the result agrees with the experimental value. If we follow the relativistic treatment for the electrons and following rigorous methods, we get a value very close to that of the experimental one. Thank you.